We're working on getting the mics so they're not ringing quite so bad. Welcome to ICF this morning. I want to read from John chapter 20. You know, we just had Easter, and I've been thinking, you know, we don't want to just do Easter on one time a year. The reality of Easter is really the foundation of what we believe. We believe absolutely, not only did Jesus die, but he rose again.
Man,
and there's power in that fact alone. And so it says in John chapter 20, verse 19, this is Jesus. He's appeared to the ladies. The disciples, John and Peter, have run to the tomb, and they see that it's empty. They're all trying to wrestle with what's going on. Taking place. Now, wait a minute, we're hearing that Jesus is alive, but wait, how can he be alive? How can this all happen? And so it says, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said again to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." The power, the resurrection power of the Father that rose, lifted the Son out of that grave that we know is in Jesus Christ, that same power, Jesus says, "I'm sending you out with." We have the power that is in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Would you stand with me? Lord, we give you thanks. Not only because you died for our sins, but Lord, you walked in authority, and you still walk in authority. And on the third day, you rose from the grave. Because no power could hold you down. But Lord, in your desire for us to become your people and be your church, your representatives on this earth, you have empowered us. You have given us the authority that you have. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you honor and glory.
Yes, Lord.
Because you are alive.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise you, heaven and all that's above. Praise you. Yeah.
Yes, Lord.
Bless this time, Lord God, and bless this place.
Walk her.
Come and see.
Something a little different today. Normally at the close of our worship time, I take whatever time is needed to pray specifically for people who are needing the touch of God in their life. And I didn't do that today. There's a reason for that. And the reason is this. We're going to do it here at the end of my message today. And my message today is entitled, The Power of His Touch. The Touch of Jesus. And the message comes from Matthew chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. And I want us today to take these next few moments and focus very specifically. And those of you that are here at this service today that are needing the Lord to do something significant in your spirit, in your life, I want you to listen carefully, and I want you to be encouraged today, because I believe with all of my heart, God is going to touch some people's hearts and lives today and change them in a powerful way. Can you say amen to that? Do you agree with me today, church? I believe God is in the business of changing lives. I believe He's in the business of touching people and doing something that only He can do. And I believe today He's going to do that for those of you that are here needing that touch. So I want you to anticipate. I want you to expect from God. I want you to hear from the Word today regarding this. And I want you to be ready to respond when we have time of prayer later and believe that God is going to bless you and touch you. Jesus talked and He healed and He did great things. And in this particular passage of Scripture, Matthew chapter 8, 1 through 4, it says this, when Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed Him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before Him and said, Lord, if You are willing, You can make me clean. Jesus reached out His hand, and He touched the man, and He said, I am willing, be clean. And immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, see that you don't tell anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them. A touch. A touch was all it took. And this man was clean. Now, in that touch, I believe there are several things that we need to understand and recognize. And one of the things that I want to bring out right up front here is the fact that this man came to the Lord with a sense of expectancy. He said, if You will touch me. He believed that if Jesus would touch him, he would be made whole. You see, there's something important about this expectancy thing, this belief, this recognizing the power of God to change your life. He didn't come apologetically. He didn't come with some kind of a sense of, well, maybe it will take care of me. He came before the Lord and He said, if You'll do this, I will be made whole. I will be cleansed. He believed. How many times have we come to the Lord and said, Lord, I need Your touch upon my life. I need You to do something specific in my spirit, in my body, in my life, in my family, in my friends, in my school, in my work. And we can go on and on and on. But we did so in a way that almost spoke more unbelief than belief. We recognized, yeah, God, You can do it. But I'm not sure You will. And then we wonder why He doesn't. The power of His touch is significant. The power of that touch is special. The touch itself, when we talk about the touch, We recognize the specialness of touching. You know, there are five senses that all of us share alike together. Sight, hearing, taste, smell, and touch. Every one of us share those senses. All of them are important. All of them are something that are special in our lives. All of us cherish them, whether we think about it or not, and oftentimes we don't. Oftentimes we just kind of take them for granted because they are such a natural part of our existence. But they're special. And every one of them bless our lives in a certain way. When we touch something, though, we become intimate with that touch because we become involved with that touch. You know, I was thinking today, I've heard of people losing some or all of their senses nearly, but I've never really heard of anybody losing the sense of touch. And as you think about that this morning, you might wonder, well, what would it be like if I lost my hearing? What would it be like if I lost my sight? Those of you that are a part of the ICF family know, at least in part, some of the difficulty and the struggle that I've had over the past few years with my failing vision and all of the efforts that they have done to try to correct that or to stop it, and it's been difficult. And I've found myself sometimes thinking, what would it be like if everything failed and I lost my sight? It would be challenging. But there comes a point where each one of us have to recognize the fact that if we truly belong to the Lord, if we're His child, if we've given our heart and life to Him, even if some of these things disappeared from our life, He would still be Lord of all, and He would still bless us, He would still love us, and He would still take care of us. But yet that one sense, that touch, is something that I've never known someone to lose. I've heard of it being increased. Again, as an example, for those who lose their vision, they will tell you, usually their hearing becomes more sensitive and their touch becomes more sensitive. That's why they can read books by Braille, by those little dots. They become so sensitized to it that they can feel the difference in that touch. Can you imagine with me for a moment this morning? Can you imagine with me what it would be like if you were not able to touch the world around you? Think about it. Again, we so commonly think about loss of hearing, loss of vision, loss of taste, maybe, or other things, but how many times have you found yourself really stopping and thinking about what would it be like if I lost my sense of touch? If I couldn't touch something and know what it was like? You know, we touch thousands of things every day. We don't even think about it. Sometimes the touch is significantly wonderful, and sometimes we just don't even pay any attention to it, and sometimes we touch things and we wish we hadn't. But it becomes a very, very special part of our life. There's something very significant about touching, something that we often don't think much of. Think of what it means as an example. When you reach out and you touch someone, it says to them, most generally, that you care about them. Here at ICF and in many of our church bodies, we often greet one another with a hug or with a hand on the shoulder or something like that. And what that is saying is, I care about you. You are special in my life. And that's powerful. It's meaningful. There are people that yearn for that kind of thing over and over and over again in their life, and they never really find it or receive it. But yet in the body of Christ, we in essence, I believe, become a reflection of the love of Jesus through the power of our touch, sharing that love with those around us. It's important, and it's special. Oftentimes our touch can change an object. Significantly changes. And I want to talk this morning for just a few moments about a touch that is superior to any human touch that we can ever feel. I want to talk about the touch of Jesus. I want us to be reminded today of the power of God and the touch that changes everything. When he extends his hand into your life, when he purposely reaches out and touches you, he will produce changes that no other touch can make. It's the supernatural power of God that makes a difference in our life. And there are several aspects of that touch today that I want to point out in a way to you of introduction into this. First of all, his touch is an intimate touch. When Jesus touched this leper, it demonstrated a desire, a wonderful desire, on his part to become intimately involved with this man's life. Nobody else was going to touch him. In fact, they were going to stay as far away as they could because they knew about the leprosy and they knew about what that meant, and they knew that a touch on this man could, in essence, bring that disease into them, and they weren't going to touch him. This man, it's no telling how long it had been since this man had felt the touch of anyone, a touch of care and a touch of love. And yet Jesus reached out and touched him. An intimate, wonderful touch. Secondly, his touch is powerful. It changes things. He touched Simon and he became Peter. It changed his life. He touches a Jacob and he becomes Israel, the Prince of God. He touched and transforms Abram into Abraham. He touches and transforms the defeated Elijah and made Elijah a man of God, a powerful man of God. He touched and changed Moses, who was lived a life amongst the Egyptians and even went into a time of where he committed murder. And this leader became a leader of all people through the touch of God. His touch can transform a nobody. Amen. And make that person something powerful and wonderful that will change the atmosphere around them. Amen. Church, I want to tell you something this morning. We need his touch. Amen. You need his touch.
Amen.
I need his touch. We need that touch upon our life because his touch changes everything. It's transforming. It transforms our life and it makes things new. And today, if you're here in this service and you're struggling with some area in your life or there's something going on in your spirit, or there's something going on physically in your body, you need today one thing. You need the touch of Jesus. And I believe his touch is available to you if you will reach out and say, Lord, touch me and make me whole.
Amen.
Just what he did for this leper, I believe he can do for you as well today. So let's talk for just a moment about a few important aspects of this touch that we're talking about here. Who has Matthew chapter 8 and verse 15?
I do.
All right, please read it quickly.
He touched her hand and the fever left, and she got up and began to wait on him.
Touched her hand, and what happened? The fever left. There was sickness, there was difficulty, and it all went. Why? Because Jesus touched her hand. Let me tell you something, no doctor will do that for you. They may give you some pills or some medication, or they may prescribe some things that may indeed help or work, but you see, with Jesus, all it took was a touch. A powerful, intimate touch. Jesus touched her and healed, as only he could do. She was in a hopeless situation. She was in a condition that needed something significant and something powerful. And Jesus touched her and changed her life. His touch cleanses. His touch cleanses physically, and his touch cleanses us spiritually. When you receive Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, when you call out to God and you ask his forgiveness for the sin in your life, I can tell you, he will touch you and he will make you clean under his precious shed blood. His touch will change you in a powerful way. Who has Mark 7:33?
I
am. Okay.
After he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he stood and touched the man's tongue.
Okay. Here we find an example of how that touch can change the deaf. This man could not communicate with anyone. He could not hear. He could not speak. But when Jesus touched him, all of that changed. All of it changed. And he does the same for those who call out to him in this day. We call out in the name of Jesus, Lord, change me. Forgive me. Cleanse me. And when that touch takes place, there's a transformation that happens. Those who are saved by God are given the ability to hear him clearly. You see, he wants to communicate with us. It gives us the ability to hear him. It gives us the ability to speak to him openly. And it changes our life. Who has Matthew 9:29?
Then he touched their eyes and said, according to your faith, it be done to you. And their sight was restored.
Hallelujah. His touch transforms darkness into light.
Amen.
Think about it, church. Here's a man born blind at birth. He is miraculously touched and healed by the touch of the Lord Jesus. And now he can see again. No one else could do that. No one else had the ability or the desire, probably even. But he touched him and he could see. It's the same with our spiritual sight too. When Jesus touches our heart and our life, he changes us. He opens our spiritual eyes and we can see things around us much differently than we saw it before, because he has opened our spiritual vision and we can see the things of God that he has for us around us. Things that we've never thought about before. Things that were right around us, and we didn't see them. They become visible. They become clear when he touches us. It's almost like the old horses that had the blinders on, here and here. They could only see this. Sometimes we walk around in a spiritual condition as if we have those blinders on, and we can only see exactly what's ahead of us. But when Jesus touches us, the blinders are taken away, and we can see things clearly for his glory and for his purpose. Matthew 8:3.
Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy.
All right. Here's someone who was doomed. Leprosy was an incurable disease that meant one thing: you're going to die. You're going to die a miserable, lonely death. People with leprosy were excommunicated. They weren't even allowed in the city. They were cast outs. They were cast away. They could not even communicate with those around them. This person was doomed. His body was ravaged by this disease. He was doomed to spending a life of separation from all other human beings. Can you think about how painful that would be? Can you imagine for a moment what it would be like to be in a situation where you are told you can have no contact with anyone? Your people you love, your family, your friends, or even people that you don't even know currently. Suddenly you're put in a position where you are not allowed to have any contact with them. You are cast out and you are set apart. You are set aside. The only people you might be able to have communication with are people in the same situation that you yourself are now in. That's a terrible thing. That's a hard thing. And that's what this person found themselves in. But listen, Jesus changed that. How did he do it? He did it with a touch. And it's the same for every lost soul today. If your spirit and your heart is not right with God and you're here this morning, maybe you've had a relationship with him at one time, or maybe you never have. I want to tell you something. All you've got to do is say, "Lord, touch me and make me whole." I guarantee you he'll do that. And you'll feel that touch. And it will change you. It will change you powerfully. It will restore you and make you whole. Luke 8:54. Who has it?
"But he put them all outside and took her by the hand and called, saying, 'Little girl, arise.'"
His touch transformed the dead. Think about it. He had the power over death. At his touch, at his command, even the dead must surrender and rise. We're talking about the power of God, church. If he can do that for the dead, think what he can do for you. At least right now, you're still breathing.
Amen.
Amen. I think. You're not asleep. I think. Think what God can do for you. Think what he wants to do for you. There are a lot of spiritual sleepwalkers around today. Unfortunately, we've had a few of them in ICF. They're sleepwalking their existence. All they profess Christ, they proclaim Christ to a degree, but most of their life is walked around completely void of his touch. Maybe they've experienced that touch at some time, but they've forgotten what it's like, or it's been stolen away from them by the power of the enemy. Oh, they still remember enough to know about it, but they don't have it here. It's the same with being doomed by sin. Some people walk around with this void of knowing that they're doomed to eternity without the Lord because there's unforgiven sin. No one can forgive that sin except Jesus. No one can change that life except by His touch. And they don't even cry out and say, Lord, heal me. And so they suffer the fate of eternal death. And it's so unnecessary. Jesus paid the price that all could be saved. All. If only we would get a hold of that. If only people around us would begin to understand that. If only we could communicate that in such a way to people that we know that right now don't know what it is to feel the touch of Jesus and let their life be eternally changed. When we pray for people, when we ask people to accept Christ, we emphasize to them, we want them to know this is not a change for a day or a week or a month or a year. This is meant to be a change for all of eternity. Christ didn't give Himself so that you could have a few days of feeling better. He gave Himself that you could spend eternity with Him. Amen. Then Christ shall rise. The doomed will receive the power to live because of this man's touch. Luke 22:51.
And one of them struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. And he touched the ear and healed him.
Wow. Think of that. Think of that. Who can do that? Who can do that? If Francis took a knife out and cut Dennis's ear off. Don't get nervous, Dennis. He doesn't have one out.
I didn't
have
one.
If that took place, how many of you could walk over here and take that ear and heal it? There's not a doctor in Florence that could do that. No one. But the power of the touch of Jesus, that's all it took. That's incredible, church. We're talking power here. We're talking love here. We're talking healing here that only Jesus can do. And all it takes is this. The touch of the Lord. That's all it takes. It's done. It's the same with our spiritual life. That's all it takes. He comes to us and He offers us life within Himself. And all it takes is His touch. All we have to say is, Lord, here I am. Touch me. And make me whole. Many of you will remember oftentimes when we pray for people here around this altar, we pray a prayer asking for wholeness in their life. You see, I believe when Jesus heals someone, when Jesus takes them in their spirit or in their body or whatever the need is, Jesus touches them and He makes all things new.
Amen.
There's a wholeness that takes place. And the only limit to that wholeness is we ourselves. He wants to make us new. He wants to transform us through the power of His touch. Matthew 17:7.
But Jesus came and touched them. Get up, He said. Don't be afraid.
Hallelujah. Think of this. The disciples, they were afraid. Anybody here ever been afraid?
Oh, you bunch of chickens.
You're afraid right now. You won't lift your hand up and say, yeah. We've all been there. We've all been afraid of something or some experience. Sometimes that fear is a good thing. There is a healthy fear. We teach our children, don't put your hand in the fire because it'll burn you. We instill in them a fear of being harmed by certain things that they might do. That's a healthy fear. But there's a fear also that comes that limits us spiritually. How many times have you been sensitive to the voice of the Holy Spirit saying, go over there and share my love with that person? Someone you didn't probably even know. Maybe someone you did know vaguely. Maybe someone you knew really well. But the Spirit of God says, share my love with that individual. And you say, there's a fear of rejection. There's a fear of not saying the right thing in the right way. Not doing it right. Oftentimes people say, well, I don't know what to say. That's a fear. You see, there comes a time when we need to understand that if God calls us to do something, if he says to share his love with somebody, he'll provide you with what you need to do it. If God told me to go over here and speak to Ina about something, I could sit back and say, well, God, I don't know what to say. But there comes an acceptance that says, you know what, Lord? I'm your vessel. Fill me. Use me. If he calls me to do it, he's going to provide. He's going to take away the fear. There's a fear factor that needs to be destroyed in our life because as a child of the King, we need to be bold in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Disciples, they were afraid. But yet, Jesus cast away the fear. He did what only he could do, and it changed their lives. Church, listen to me this morning. Have you felt the power of his touch? Do you know the power of that touch in this moment? Sometimes we say, yeah, God touched me 3 years ago. It was wonderful. And you're sitting there wondering, but I haven't felt it lately, and I don't know why. Come on, be honest. I've mentioned before about how people in our churches used to talk to us about, oh, God moved so powerfully in this church 25 years ago. It was so glorious. It was so wonderful. People were saved every service, and people were healed, and great things took place 25 years ago. And my question is, what's happened since? I mean, I give thanks to God for 25 years ago. Glory to God. But what about today? And what about tomorrow? If you've been touched by the Master's hand in your life, praise God for that. But you see, I don't believe that he limits that touch to a certain time, place, and it's then and then alone. God wants to touch you every day. He wants to change things in your life every day. He wants to move powerfully in your life every day. He wants to move powerfully in the life of this body of believers every time we come together. And it happens by his touch. It happens by the moving of his Spirit that touches and changes hearts and lives for his glory. Do we really understand what he truly can do in our life and in the lives of those around us? If today you would be honest and bold enough to say, I need the touch of Jesus today. You see, that's not discounting or putting down your spirituality. It's not making you any less than who you are in Christ. You know, every time I call for people for prayer, almost without exception, I will remind them of the fact that just because you have a need in your life doesn't make you any less a child of the King. The devil wants you to think you're something cast out, cast aside, and downtrodden, and of no use whatsoever because you have need in your life. That's a lie. I believe need in our life is just an opportunity to let Jesus show his power in and through us. If we'll trust him and we'll receive his touch. And today, if you're here in this service and you would be honest and you would say, Pastor, I need the touch of Jesus in my life today. Maybe it's something of a spiritual need. Maybe there's something in your relationship with the Lord that is not what it should be. Maybe you find yourself in a position where you haven't been as close to Him as you really want to be or should be. Maybe your prayer life has slacked or suffered. Maybe your time in the Word of God has been lax. Maybe your time in the house of worship has been lax and put aside. I want to tell you something today. Jesus loves you, and all it takes is if you'll cry out to Him and say, Lord, renew, restore, do something powerful in my life, I guarantee He will run to you and He will touch you.
Amen.
In this moment. Because that's His desire for you. Maybe you have a need physically in your body today. I want you to know there's no greater physician than Jesus Christ.
Amen.
There's not a disease, there's not a sickness. There's not anything that maybe you might be suffering from an injury or whatever, that is simply the touch of His hand, He cannot heal. He's still the healer. He's still the miracle worker. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Some people want to say, well, He used to do those things, but that time's gone. That's nonsense. Show me in the Word of God where it says Jesus will do this and this and this up to such and such and such year, and after that it's over. You won't find it. He still wants to touch you today. He still wants to do the miraculous today. He still wants to change your life. And He still wants to change you so that He can use you for His glory. He wants to take the fear away. And He wants to make you a mighty man and woman of God. And if you're a child of the King today, that ought to be your heart's cry. Lord, use me. Whether you're lost, whether you've fallen back in your relationship with the Lord, whether you're carrying burden or weight today, whether you're discouraged, or whether you just want to learn more about this great love that He has for you, all you need is His touch. And He will change things. Now, sometimes we have circumstances and situations in our lives that doesn't just instantly, I'm not talking to you necessarily sometimes about He just touches you and everything magically disappears and everything's wonderful. Sometimes that happens. But sometimes because of circumstances or situations or something He's walking us through to teach us, He'll take away the hurt, He'll take away the pain, He'll take away the heart, but He'll let you walk through the consequences of that situation so that you can better know Him in the power of His touch and you can be better witness of what God can do in someone else's life. Sometimes it's just the consequences of sin. Sometimes we just need the lesson of that. It doesn't mean we're not forgiven. It simply means that we have to walk through the consequences. I like what I was talking about earlier. If a child puts their hand in the fire, you can yank that hand back, and And you can put ointment on and creams on and medication, and that burn will heal. But there will be the consequences of that. It will stick around for a while. Sometimes that happens in our spiritual life. Sometimes it happens in our physical life. But still the power of God comforts, strengthens, and takes care. His touch. Church, we need His touch today. Every person in this room, in some fashion or some manner, needs His touch today. I don't have to know you personally. I don't have to know you intimately. Some of you I know about circumstances and situations, some things God shows to me about individuals' lives, and I can understand the need that's there, and I can tell you right now, God wants to touch you. But He's like so many things. He's not going to force it on you. He's going to offer it to you. He's going to do everything He can to get you to respond. But He'll never force you. You can receive His touch today. But He's not going to give it if you're standing there like this. Don't touch me. I want you to take these few moments. Dennis, I'm going to ask you to come, please. I want you to take these next few moments. Dennis is going to lead us in a worship for us. But I want you to take a moment, and I want you to carefully think, and let the Holy Spirit help you to understand the need in your life for His touch. And in a moment, I'm going to ask those of you that would say, Lord, I need Your touch. Come and we're going to pray for you. And I believe God's going to do some incredible things around these altars with His touch. Let's spend a moment and let's worship, let's pray, and let's listen to the voice of God. Let me just share one last thing with you. need the touch of Jesus. You will not survive without it. Our church needs the touch of Jesus. Satan's been trying and trying, and he's been working overtime on people within the body of ICF and upon the ministry of ICF this past year. And you know what? I'm sick of it. And it's time we as the body of Christ, we as the body of ICF, say enough. Touch us, change us, and let's go forward for the kingdom. And I'm asking you today to stand in the power of his touch and believe for greater things for the kingdom of God. This city needs a move of Jesus. And you know how that's going to happen? It's going to happen when we begin to learn to flow under the power of his touch. Believe it. Know it. Stand on it and move in. We've got to move in the power of his touch. We've got to touch people with that same love. We've got to stand that in love. You understand what I'm saying, church? It's time we stand in Jesus' name. It's time we go forward in Jesus' name. Pray. You ask God to strengthen you and use you. It's time you reach out and pray for someone who needs healing. It's time you reach out and pray for someone who needs salvation. It's time you reach out and pray for someone that needs to be encouraged. It's time you take hold of the gift that God has given to you as a child of the King and use it for his glory. About changing one person at a time. With his touch and with his love. And every one of you are a part of that. Believe it right now. Believe it. Stand on it. Don't let the devil steal it away from you. And let's move forward for the kingdom. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Do you believe it?
Yes. Yes.
Then let's do it for the glory of God. Sing it one more time. Break every chain. Come on. Come on, let's sing it together. Sake. Lord, I pray your blessings upon this body today. Strengthen them, encourage them. Build up within them a boldness to be used by your Spirit. Help them, Lord, to be brave soldiers for the cross. Help them, Lord, to go forth and lay claim to the victories that you have promised. Lord, help us to be what you call us to be. I pray now your blessings, your protection over each one today. Put a hedge around them, Lord. Keep them safe. Lord, use them. Use them for your glory today. Somehow, someway, with someone, use them for your glory. But Lord, let us walk changed by the power of your touch. In Jesus' mighty name, and everyone say,